All right.
Anybody remember what the Parthians were known for in terms of how they fought? They fought on horseback. They were these famous horse archers. They proved really, really troublesome for the Romans up until the time of Augustus. One of Augustus's great successes was avenging the death of a previous general who had been associated with his adopted father, Julius Caesar. Okay, so let the rider to be feared harass, maybe is a good way to do Rexa. Harass the fierce Parthians, okay, and now hosta.
That's an adverb, right?
Yes.
Spear.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So the rider, generally when, I guess spear is right, I think of it as a lance, because I'm thinking of a knight, right? But it's the same thing. Long pointed weapon carried by a horse person. Okay, so, and let the rider to be feared harass the fierce Parthian with his spear, and final part of this horrendous sentence, let him agape his vitam. Now, is this going to be the boy, or is it going to be the rider, or is it some amalgam of both? It's singular. I don't think it really matters, because our speaker is clearly recommending to his friend that military service be compulsory. This is kind of like recommending a draft in today's context. Okay, so, and let him, to agat the witam is to lead a life. So let him, or spend a life, let him spend his life, okay, sub divo. This is kind of fun because divos, the actual meaning of divos is divine, but for reasons that have to do with the way language is developed, it became one of the standard ways, especially for poets, to talk about the sun or even the heaven. So literally what he's saying is let him spend his life under the divine thing. But what it brought across to the reader is let him spend his life outdoors, under the open sky. Okay, this is one of these fun word order things that are not helpful. Trepidis in rebus all has to go together, despite the fact that a prose author would just have said in rebus trepidis. Okay, so let him spend his life under the sky and in scary things, right? I mean, that's what trepidus is. So that's the opening sentence, the opening sentiment of this ode. And it's really hard to figure out where he's going with it, especially because the next thing that happens is weird in its own way, because suddenly our scene shifts and we're looking in a kind of completely different direction. Il ex moenigos hosticis matrona bellantis tyranni prospiciens et adulta virgo suspiret eheum, ne rudis ad minum sponsus lacessat regius asperum tactu leonem, quem cruenta per medias rapid ira caedes. Okay, so, ilum comes from the pronoun, demonstrative pronoun, ile, that. So, ilum is going to be that man. And we have to assume that we've now conflated, if there were three, maybe there were two people, we're talking about a Roman soldier. The Roman soldier that Horace has just recommended be put into service, drafted, whatever. That one, ex moenibus hosticis, from enemy walls. Now, we'll go on with our hortatory, our let ex happen, and the Roman wouldn't really have needed to kind of suspend all that through, but it'll help us because we're going so slowly. That man, that soldier, from the hostile walls, the enemy walls, let the mother, and not just a mother, but a matrona was a very special word, different from mater. Generally, I think the easiest way to talk about it is it conveys a kind of nobility. To be the matrona of a Roman family meant you were in that patrician class, or the middle class, the equites. So let the, we'll just say mother. Let the mother of the Bellantis Tyranni, now this is actually that same word that gives Bellantor his name. So bellum war, bello, the verb to be at war or to war. The mother of the warring prince, probably the best way to translate Tyranni. Let the mother of the warring prince prospiciens, is going to go with ex moenibus hosticis. So that one, let the mother of the warring tyrant looking forth from the enemy walls, and let the grown-up young woman sigh over, we have to say, although the tie between Ilum and Suspiret isn't quite as grammatical as you might like it to be. So this thought, where we've suddenly taken the boy who has been forced into military service, although I guess the fiction is going to be, especially since we're going to end up with this famous sentiment, the fiction is going to be that he's willingly going out there to give his life for his patria. Okay, so suddenly that guy is being sighed over by some mom of some warlike tyrant and by some grown-up young woman, alas, lest her sponsus. We have to assume that the semantic types are close enough that we have to assume that the adulta virgo is going to be married to the sponsus. So lest the sponsus lacesset, lest he harass, I guess, maybe the best way to do it, or rouse to fury, maybe. So he's that sponsus, the fiance of the adulta virgo, is going to be royal. And he's also going to be rudis adveum, meaning he's inexperienced of the ranks of war. So the situation is you have this tyrant who is engaged to be married to the adulta virgo, and although you would think that both his mother and his fiance would be kind of sighing over him, no, they're actually sighing over the Roman dude. Who is coming probably to kill the sponsors because he is rudis agonum, he's inexperienced at the ranks of war. Alas, they sigh over him lest the sponsors vex the harsh lion, harsh to the touch lion, meaning you shouldn't touch him because if you touch the lion, you die. Okay, and that one, who again is the Ilum, the Roman soldier, whom cruel anger seizes through the middle of the slaughter. So we've got this thing set up where the Romans are sending their sons to be educated in hard service. And they go to these foreign places like Parthia. And in those foreign places, they are kind of par excellence the best soldiers, and even if you have the Matrona and the adulta virgo looking forth from the walls at this battle, the Roman soldier is still going to take out the tyrant in the slaughters that are going to take place. Okay, and then we finally get to this incredibly famous sentiment, and we have to kind of cast our minds back to a time when nobody knew what this meant. Nobody, when Horace was writing it for the very first time. Dulc, using the allusions that a Roman would have done, dulc et decoronst pro patria mori. It is sweet and very hard to translate this word. You can say beautiful, you can say fitting. It depends on a root decus, which also gives us decoration. And a decoration, we think of it as just something that's pretty, but also a key part of a decoration is that it suits the place where you put it. And it's a kind of key to what it, how it functions. So it's sweet and beautifully fitting, maybe, to die for the fatherland. People will debate forever how seriously Horace meant this in this context, and this is probably the place to switch out of the Latin and to look at the English. John and Christiana, feel free to stick around for the discussion in English if you want, or to take off, and I'd like to confer over the next few days about about whether and how useful this format was for going through the stuff, whether it gave you material for annotations. Okay, so 10:07, hopefully.